Welcome, everyone. Thank you again for joining us. We will go ahead and get started, and I think we will have more people joining us as the today's program progresses. So thanks for being here. We're glad that you're with us. I'm Suzanne Godby Inglesby, the Associate Director of IU's Institute for Advanced Study, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to today's Research and Repositories webinar. Before we get going, the IU Institute for Advanced Study recognizes that Indiana University is built on the ancestral homelands and resources of the Miami, Delaware, Potawatomi, and Shawnee people. We acknowledge and honor these Indigenous communities, both past and present. For additional information about this, I suggest looking at the Indigenize Indiana page on the IU First Nations Educational and Cultural Center website. Today, we are pleased to have with us Dr. Ellie Armon Azoulay and IU PhD student in ethnomusicology, Nia I'man Smith. They will be discussing listening and rethinking in the archives. And that conversation will begin in just a moment. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank our colleagues at the Archives of Traditional Music, particularly ATM Director Alan Burdett and Librarian Allison McClanahan, for facilitating this research fellow's visit and work, and for their help in setting up today's event, helping us coordinate the details. I'd also like to thank IAS Coordinator Elizabeth Kahn and our GA Taylor Zartman for all they do to make these events possible, behind the scenes, through email, on camera, all of those things. I'm grateful for all of my great colleagues and the network of help that they provide. We'll be hosting more of these repository research-focused presentations and conversations in the coming weeks and months. And if you'd like to be notified of these events, you can join our email list by sending a request to ias@indiana.edu. That's lowercase IAS for Institute for Advanced Study. And you can also follow us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and on our website. The format of today's program is going to be a little bit different than some of our other webinars for those of you who have been with us before. At the request of our guests, today's presentation is going to invite all the attendees, all of you, to turn on your cameras and be visible throughout the discussion. We'll follow regular virtual meeting protocols of keeping ourselves muted unless it's our turn to speak, but you're also welcome to unmute yourself and chime in as you like throughout the discussion when you have questions or comments or want to share something. And if you prefer not to do either of those things, that's also fine. You may still send questions through the chat or the Q&A, and one of us who are IAS staff members will share those for you either with your name or anonymously as you let us know. Today's presentation and the discussion are going to be recorded and available for later access. So choosing to turn on your camera or your mic will indicate to us your consent to be part of that recording. If you prefer not to be, then go ahead and leave your camera and mic off, and you are welcome to just sit and take it in. So now I will be very happy to introduce our lead discussants today. Ellie Armon Azoulay from Newcastle University in the UK is a repository research fellow of the IU Institute for Advanced Study. She's a cultural historian of the late 19th and 20th century United States. Her practice is informed by her diverse experiences, ranging from research, curatorial work, art criticism, and DJing, curating radio sets on protest histories and sounds. Dr. Armon Azoulay is a research fellow at the Eccles Center at the British Library. Her article, The Practice of Refusal in Willis Lawrence James Song Collecting, was recently published in a special issue on Culture of Protest in American Music and Comparative American Studies. An essay on Zora Neale Hurston's sound recordings in the New Deal Archive is forthcoming in a new anthology about her work. She's working on her first monograph, Reclaiming the Lore, African American Music Collectors, Refusal and Anti-Preservationist Practices. So welcome to Dr. Armon Azoulay. In conversation with us also today is Nia I'man Smith, a second year PhD student in ethnomusicology at Indiana University Bloomington. Her research exploring ancestor veneration in Black music has been presented at the 2019 MoPOP Conference, Rutgers Paul Robeson Galleries, and the Juneteenth Mbongi Collective. She is the creator, producer, and lead voice of Sonic Blackness, a podcast at the intersection of Black music and memory. Nia is also the creator of The Black Connection, a multi-platform exploration of the music, visual culture, and Orisha traditions of the Black diaspora. Under this platform, her interactive project, Ritual Cools the Head, a public ritual exchange, has been featured at the 2022 Herman C. Hudson Symposium and many other venues. Prior to her studies at IU, Nia held administrative and educator positions at Studio Museum in Harlem, Weeksville Heritage Center, Brooklyn Museum, Arts Connection, and BRIC. And I just want to take a moment to note that Elizabeth has been helping me out by dropping links in the chat to these different articles, podcasts, projects that I've just mentioned. So if you're interested in one of those, take a look at the chat. And welcome to Nia. Thank you also for being here. So right now, I'm going to turn this over to our guests, and I'm going to invite you all to please turn on your cameras, although not yet your mics. And I'll stop talking and let these other folks talk, and we hope that you'll come and join us in the room.
So good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for coming. I would also like to start with some thank yous for the Institute of Advanced Studies and the Archives of Traditional Music, for Suzanne and Alan and Allison, and the fantastic graduate students that have been helping me throughout my visit and made it very accommodating, answering all my questions and supporting me throughout the research. I would also like to thank Nia for taking this invitation to be in conversation. I'm very grateful for that. And just maybe to say what we had in mind, I will speak at roughly 10 minutes. I would really like to introduce some of the frameworks of my research and then to move to Nia and open it up for a conversation between us. We also wanted to emphasize that this is a kind of a workshopping, open-ended conversation, a beginning of something rather than an end, and we really want you to be engaged as much as you want to. So I just want to note that my research here is in very early stages. I've been lucky to listen to the recording materials of Andrew Carr from Trinidad and Lorenzo Dow Turner from many places, which I can speak about soon. And it's still I've been listening to many hours of recording materials, and I'm still processing that, and it will take time, which is both a bit scary but also very exciting. But I did come already with some kind of ideas and kind of a groundwork that I've been working as part of an ongoing project that I titled Reclaiming the Lore. So I just want to introduce briefly some of these kind of frameworks and ideas and maybe how it evolved, and then open it up to broader things. So first of all, I wanted to note how entering this field of collecting, at first it was African-American folk music, but then African folk music really required a lot of consideration and care. Due to the fact that as a field of study, it's been established and dominated by mostly white men for many, many years. And these men have meticulously studied these songs and music through various categories, standards, and classification system, which I will not get to speak about today. They study each other's works and their predecessors. And this project was not an attempt to add to this kind of knowledge that they produce. And that's something that was very important for me. I've been recently reading Mark Anthony Neal's recent book, Black Ephemera, and he speaks a lot about the commodification of Black culture, but also about the demystification of the labor that produced Black culture and cultural criticism, which I found in the practice of these collectors that I've been researching. He speaks a lot about the digital stage and era whereby everybody can access Black culture without bearing the responsibility for its care and sustenance. So while he speaks about the digital realm, I think it's very relevant to that moment where I started my research of the 20th century, this moment of data collection and building archives that has roots in imperial origins. So in contrast to this kind of ideas and origins, my project tried to avoid claiming or employing an authoritative expertise on the music itself and its various meaning. So I tried to define clearly my boundaries within that and to centralize the interpretive and analysis of the music through the voice and the writing of the Black collectors I've been listening to and studying. And I thought it's not my wish to do this kind of work, and I didn't think it was my place as a non-Black writer. But my research did have some commitments. One was the exploration of different approaches and methodologies that were crucial to this framework that I was thinking through, this idea of reclaiming the lore, and also to situate this practice of reclamation with other practices of refusal to comply with structures of white supremacy and subjugation, but also fugitivity from those structures, how they were developed and practiced by generation of Black people across the diaspora. And by drawing on, for example, Black feminist thought, the Black radical tradition, and Black studies in large, in order to facilitate a different entry point to the practice of these Black collectors, which I've studied, which I'll introduce in a second. So how it needed to move away from the field of folk music studies as it was articulated by this dominant group. So it felt necessary that the articulation of this reclamation project and its importance will be reconstructed from the scrutiny of the work and the passionate commitment of Black collectors from across the African diaspora, and also from the individuals and communities who perform the songs. So I started this idea by remapping the field of collecting. At first, I focused on the 20th century as this moment where collecting has been really popularized and expanded. It aligned with other historical moments of the New Deal, the turn of the century, pseudo-eugenic ideas, all sorts of things correlated with this moment. But as I worked through the work of African-American collectors and across generation, it became clear that I need to go back to the mid-19th century and the end of the 19th century. And how this moment was also crucial to processes of meaning making, but also of community and institution building. So I started to look at collectors that at first I saw in the footnotes maybe of those white collectors, and either in their archives, there was some mentions of collectors, of African-American collectors, or in the written or published materials, musical and written. So I worked on Zora Neale Hurston, which was a playwright, a novelist, an anthropologist, ethnomusicologist, and many more, and a cultural critic. And Willis Lawrence James, who was a musician, educator, composer, violinist, and a collector of music, of course, and the Work family, at least three generation of John Work, the first, the second, and the third from Nashville, who were also involved in composition, in performance, in education. So it was essential to identify at first these conditions of their marginalization, how certain individual collectors and white institutional archives have exploited, appropriated, and extracted from their labors, their knowledge, and their access. There are many examples to that. I will not get to that today. But after doing that, or while doing that simultaneously, it was very important to centralize their work, their writing, and the centrality and the far-reaching contribution of their practice through both collecting, but also through performance and education and other creative formats. So for example, a lot of them have been working in various Black schools throughout the South with historically Black colleges and universities. They have been colleagues, they have exchanged with each other. And then I started tracing, in order to expand this mapping that I was creating, their extensive collaboration and exchange with wide networks of people that committed to recording, performing, but also enlivening African-American folk music. So for example, through this history of HBCU, through church union organization, et cetera. That had led me quickly to realize that there's a need to extend who and how is being included within the practice of collecting. So to think differently about informants, to think differently about certain union leaders whom these collectors have met and have been also known as, for example, trainers of choirs and other singing groups among their working communities. But also to think, for example, about performers. And I'm thinking about Ella Shepherd from the Fisk Jubilee Singers. It is known that she moved about around certain Southern communities, collecting materials that then enriched the repertoire of the choir. So to think about that, like how did she thought about her practice, amassing songs, sharing them through performative practice, but also to think more broadly, again, to expand the conventional places where collecting take place. So to think about the civil rights activist, sharecropper, founder of the Freedom Farm Cooperative in the 1960s, Fanny Lou Hamer, and how she theorized the role of music making and sharing as part of her grassroots activism and practice. So this practice of opening the definition of the collector and the different approaches of collecting also necessitate a kind of reevaluation of other central concepts and institutions that were pertinent to this field of collecting and across its various disciplines. So hopefully we will speak about this today in the conversation a bit. So one of them would be preservation, but also archives, curation, and display. How did the performative or educational practice of these collectors had shaped their approach to preservation, for example? How did the external obsession and commodification of Black culture production have shaped their relationship with the archive, with recording? And maybe to wrap up these ideas, when talking with Nia about her work, I really liked her exploration of this idea of ancestor veneration, and it made me think about the different ways some of the collectors I've been listening to experimented and engaged with that, how it took place through a meaning making of the past, but also of a certain very specific moment at the present, looking and claiming ancestral traditions and lineage, but also something that moves forward to think about a kind of inheritance, which hopefully Nia will pick up as well. So I want to finish with playing two songs that are very different in many ways with regard to music making and meaning making, but also to think through their exploration of ancestral tradition or veneration. So I'd like to start with a song by Fanny Lou Hamer. This recordings for Folkways Records is from the 1960s, but these songs and the practices of sharing those songs were widely used by her prior to that. So this is one song, and the other song is from this visit to the archive of Lorenzo Turner. And it's a recording from the 1950s, so either 52 or 56 were years that he's been in Nigeria. So it wasn't clear the date of that. And it is Lorenzo Turner started searching for such ancestral traditions and retention of African traditions, first with the Gullah people and dialect at the Sea Islands in 1929, but then he started to embark on a longer journey to retrace such African diasporic vernacular traditions. So he went to study the Creoles of Louisiana, the Portuguese and Creole in Brazil, Sierra Leone, and then to Nigeria and Benin and other places to study Yoruba languages and dialects. So this song was recorded in Nigeria, in Ibadan. And it's called, it's part of Song of Sorrow and Rejoicing. And this specific title of the song is a song of gratitude to God for the abolition of the slave trade, 1807, Yoruba. It starts with a small introduction and then a short song. And I thought this was interesting, and maybe we can speak about it later with regard to this idea of like the present, the past, but also the future. So let me play that. And I'll pass it to Nia.
All right, excuse me. Good morning, everyone. Good morning, good morning. I hope that, excuse me, all is well. with everyone. And so to begin, I too have a couple of thank yous and acknowledgements that I would like to go through. So first and foremost, Ellie, I would like to thank you for this opportunity to be in conversation. This emerged from last Friday, you know, us first lamenting the Roe v. Wade decision, and then also just beginning to have some conversations about our mutual work. And I'm just really grateful to you that you asked me, as somebody who was so early in the academic stages of their journey, to be in conversation to think through some of these ideas. So thank you for that. I also want to thank the Archives of Traditional Music, as well as the Institute for Advanced Study, for hosting this conversation, as well as my home department, the Department of Folklore and Ethnomusicology. I cannot begin this conversation, especially given my work around ancestor veneration, without naming and paying homage to the ancestors in my family line. So I want to call the name of my great aunt Essie, Essie Neely Manning. I want to call out the name of my brother, Malik Youssef Neely. I want to call out the names of my grandparents, Mr. Levy C. Neely, Mrs. Colleen Smith, Mrs. Minnie Neely as well, Mama Lou and Papa Dennis, and as well as all of the ancestors who are on the Smith sides and the Neely sides of my family, whose names go unknown, but still whose shoulders I stand upon. I also want to give homage and venerate the ancestors who are filling our conversation today. So calling out the name of Zora Neale Hurston, Dr. Lorenzo Dow Turner, the Work family, Dr. Samuel Floyd, Dr. Eileen Southern, Dr. Valerie Boyd, Dr. Willis Lawrence James, Fanny Lou Hamer, and all of these other unnamed voices who are allowing us to be able to do the work that we're doing today. I also want to give honor to IU's lineage, particularly those who have enshrined the study of Black music here. So I call out the name of Dr. Portia Maltzby. I call out the name of Dr. Melanie Burnham. I call out the name of Dr. Ronald R. Smith. I call out the name of Dr. Alicia Lola Jones. I call out the name of Dr. Fernando Oella. I call out the name of Dr. Tyron Cooper, and everyone who has contributed and come through IU Bloomington. And once again, just enshrined the study and the research of Black music here. It is because of them that I am here. And finally, I just want to thank my brilliant thinkers, as well as my thought partners, who lovingly talked me through this and hyped me up to be able to even come before you on this Zoom. So I want to thank, excuse me, Dr. All right, I know she's in here, so I'm giving her that honorific that she so well-deserved and earned. Dr. Delilah Scruggs, also Maya Cunningham, and Gerald Lavelle II, once again, for just helping me through this conversation. And so, as mentioned, once again, I am in the very early stages of my research and my thinking around this. But the ways in which I'm coming to this conversation today and being in conversation with Ellie is really thinking about how has or how does Black music sonically, lyrically, and performance serve, for the context of this conversation, as an archive for forms and acts of ancestor veneration, right? This acknowledgement of that and who has come before. And so that's part one. And then part two, where I am now, is I'm interested in really thinking through how do these forms of ancestor veneration within Black music enact and exemplify the retention of an African cultural memory. And I'm particularly drawing from the work of Dr. Samuel Floyd in his 1995 book, The Power of Black Music. Okay, let's get into page eight with that. And I'll give a shout out to somebody else who's in this space who is so lovingly talked about the importance of citation and exact citation. So really thinking about how this framework of African cultural memory is informed by African cosmological thought, belief, and practice, right? In the idea of first there being ancestors and there being ancestors to be venerated, right? And this relationship that is enacted between those who are in the ancestral realm and those of us who are in the earthly realm. And so I'm interested in looking at, right, how Black music is sounding that, right? But also thinking about this idea and this Africana studies framework by Dr. Greg Carr at Howard University of the governance structure, where he asked this question, who are African people to each other, right? And I'm hearing this idea of ancestor veneration as this enacting of this question of who are African people to each other. We are a people who care about each other. We are a people who remember each other. We are a people who venerate each other. We are a people who see our humanity, right? And despite social structures that have not or refuse to grant that. And so I'm interested in those particular questions within my research. And there are others, but once again, for the context of this conversation, that's what I'm thinking. And when Ellie approached me about the ideas of us being in conversation together, some of the lines of connection and points of connection that I saw with our respective works and joining them together is that, one, we are both engaging the work of ancestors, right, and ancestral traditions, and the lineage that their work brings forth and remember. And here I want to also call out the work of Dr. Solimar Otero, who is in the Ethnomusicology and Folklore Department on the folklore side, and particularly noting her book, Archives of Conjure, Stories of the Dead in Afro-Latinx Cultures, where she's doing this deep dive in investigating and thinking through what does it mean to engage the ancestor in the archive, right? In the archive for this particular conversation, and we're going to expand beyond that, but thinking about the archive as this, this institutional, this physical space. Really, really excellent work in there. And then also in thinking about this question of the archive, right, as this physical space, we're both using institutional archives to be able to view, as Ellie says, quote, published work, recorded music, unpublished notes, ephemera, and photography of those ancestors that we're looking at. And for me, this leaves another question that is central to my exploration of ancestor veneration in terms of thinking through what are other forms of archives that are central to the hearing of ancestor veneration in Black music. So thinking about how do we sonically hear that, right? And this is where I'm going to give my shout out to Dr. Abagunde and her work around memory as an archive, right? How can we use cultural memory as a form of thinking through what it is that we are hearing? And also record collections. Right. There's a component of that in my work as well, and thinking about these as archives as well for these sites of ancestor veneration, whether it is specifically through family and thinking about the fact that some of these records on my wall belong to my parents or in my collection belong to my Aunt Dolores, who transitioned at an early age. What are some other forms of also tangible materials that we can think through as being an archive? Just to kind of wrap up a little bit in terms of just the points of connection that I'm also thinking through with us and how I come to this conversation, is just placing our ideas about what we hear in the archive together, right? And thinking about the work that Ellie has been doing, what she's been hearing, some of the things that I'm going to investigate and playing a little bit of a sample later. How can those things be in conversation with one another? And how can those points of connection and veneration be heard in the work of culture and tradition bearers, and calling out the work of Dr. Melanie Burnham, like Dr. Turner and Zora Neale Hurston, within Black music at large. So with that little bit of introduction, at this point, we're really going to get into the engagement of this conversation. And so you're going to hear some clips of audio from both Ellie and I, and we're going to be in dialogue about how they relate within our respective works.
Thank you, Nia. This was fantastic. So can I play maybe the Zora pieces? We'll go with that. Okay. So as part of my research on Zora Neale Hurston, so we are very lucky because she had left an extensive archive of her writing, her playwright, her novels, but also her recorded music. And what's mostly interesting in the case of Hurston is that most of these recording pieces that we have from her are not necessarily of other people performing, but it's rather herself performing. And this enabled us to speak about maybe both her position, which was used but also refused through the insider-outsider position, but also about preservation differently, but also how collecting take place differently. So to think about Zora Neale Hurston through Daphne Brooks, Anne Dusile, Sonette Bretman, and other notably Black women scholars who have studied her sonic and written work. So Zora Neale Hurston recorded in 1930, so she collected from the 1920s, but this specific set of recordings that include 18 tracks was recorded in 1939 while she was working as a writer for the Federal Writers Project for the WPA, Work Progress Administration. And it is a fascinating moment of exchange. She obviously have been collecting for many years. She's very much experienced, and she's in a kind of a bizarre moment of interview with Steston Kennedy and Herbert Halpert, both of them white male, younger, less experienced than her. And you can see how in the archive she's been classified as the performer and speaker, and they are granted with the title of the collector. But when you listen to the recording, and I will play two bits of it, you can first of all see the way she approaches some of the things that Nia was thinking about, ancestral veneration, how she imagined or theorize certain performances, lineage, inspiration, but also how she approached her method of collecting. And you can see even in the recording and under the classificatory language of the archive that position her, relegate her to being a performer, you can see that she holds the knowledge. And she do that through this practice of embodied archive, where she memorized the songs she hear through her body, the gestures, the sound, the breathing pattern, etc. So I play two bits. One is a recording of a song from the Bahama, which she will introduce herself. And the other speaks more about her methods, but I think the two are working good together. That's one, and I'll play the other one, then we can maybe speak about that. That's Hali Mofak. She will introduce it, so I don't need to introduce it myself. She's both theorizing and performing and everything. So there's a lot of things to say about this recording. I will not, we don't have to say as much. I do want to point out two things. One is how the first song, Mama Don't Want No Peace, is mostly familiar through the recordings of male musicians. First, white male musician, and their Count Basie and other performers. And through the practice of Zora Neale Hurston, we get a different kind of a gender perspective on this song, and also a kind of a more mundane rendition of that that is aligned with how she observed music making and music meaning through performance in the Bahamas. If we think about the first note that she says, like, people use music through theorize and observe the world around them. And the second song, you can see how her practice is situating and keeping the authority and the expertise within the performing communities, not with an external visitors or institute of the collector that has the knowledge to interpret the community. She goes back and perform it until she gets the approval from the performing community. And that's how she then share the kind of the practice, but also through her kind of immersive performance. And we can speak about it later. And I'll pass it to Nia.
Yes, thank you so much, Ellie. I love those two clips and love hearing the sound of Zora Neale Hurston's voice. And then also thinking about and kind of picking up on your last line and thinking about these methodologies. And you'll hear me repeat it a couple of times throughout this talk is this idea of, once again, the governance structure, right? How is it that, though Zora Neale Hurston may be an outsider to this community in the sense that she is not physically from this location, right? We know that it is her positionality as a Black woman that allows her, or I'm reading it, right? My interpretation, right? And within this framework of the governance structure, as a Black woman, that dictates how it is that she is moving in this space, right? That I'm not going to be this outsider observer. I'm coming in to, as she quote says, I learn You know, I learn it, right? And that becomes another part of self-discovery that I think distinguishes what it is that we see these culture bearers doing as opposed to these white collectors who are engaging in Black folk culture during this time. And so, and kind of thinking about Ellie's call with Zora Neale Hurston, the response that I'm going to provide is thinking about this through the lens of Black contemporary music. Who is it that is calling forth the name of Zora Neale Hurston and celebrating her legacy within their lineage? And what I'm actually going to do is just for the purposes of time, because I know there were also like some other points of discussion that Ellie and I wanted to get to, is I'm just going to actually play a clip from one song, and I'll invite you all to check out the other song on your own time and think through it kind of within this framework of ancestor veneration. But we're going to listen to a little bit of the artist Candace Hoyes of her song Zora's Moon from her 2021 EP Blue Lagoon Woman. And what I want you to do is we're going to activate this chat, right? Because another thing that Ellie and I talked about, as she mentioned, right, we're workshopping ideas here, which means we're workshopping ideas in community with you all. So just as you're hearing this sample, as you're listening to it, I want you to activate the chat with just what are some of the things that you're hearing, right? There's no right, there's no wrong answer. You can think about this within the context of ancestor veneration. You can think about this outside of the context of ancestor veneration and perhaps your own work that you're engaging in various places. It's about a 2 minute and under 50 second clip. We'll listen to that. And then I'll come back and just kind of contextualize it a little bit more in terms of what Candace is saying about this song and some of the things that I'm thinking through and interpreting in the work as well. All right. So let me make sure that I share my computer audio, which it looks like it is now. And enjoy this clip from Zora's Moon. I also wanna just quickly add as I'm setting it up that it also features the work of vibraphonist Joel Ross as well, all right? I just want to point out that in the chat, Dr. Abagunde brought up, I love this groove behind the voices. Time dimensional shift collapses time and space. Yes, yes. And I'm going to get to that. I think I'm about to get to that. But I particularly want to call out first that the first thing that we hear is a sample. It begins with a sample from a 1943 radio interview between Hurston and radio host Mary Margaret McBride, right? And this is another opportunity where we get to hear Zora's first. She's not the first voice that we hear, but we get to hear this voice, right, as McBride is really giving her all of her honorifics. You're a folklorist, you're an ethnographer, you're doing this, you're doing that, right? And that serves as a point of entry for the listener, both who is initiated and uninitiated to the work of Zora Neale Hurston, right? So we can even think about that perhaps within the, and I'm just walking here right now, needs more kind of foundation, but thinking about this in the form of the Oriki, right? And the praise poem, right? Where she's really listing all of these things that Zora Neale Hurston is. And Zora Neale Hurston herself is also inserting and doing some storytelling there. I think that's also important that we hear that sample because to Dr. Abagunde's point and thinking about this collapsing of time and dimensional shift, we're hearing Zora Neale Hurston in conversation with Candace Hoyes, right? And which really gets to our understanding if we're moving outside of a European framework, if we're really looking at this from an African framework in terms of time, the way that time, past, present, and future are constantly interacting with one another and how they're constantly operating as fluid to one another, right? And it is this fluidity that really is the foundation of ancestor veneration, right? This idea because these time spaces aren't linear, right? But they're operating in movement with one another, that I am able to talk to Zora Neale Hurston, right? That I am able to seek her out as an ancestral guide, which what it is that Candace Hoyes is doing with this song. She herself notes that, and quote, this comes from an interview that she did with the radio station WBUR in Boston. She says her latest work, or this song, Zora's Moon, is a response to this moment of racial reckoning, right? Situating particularly this interview happening in 2019, and particularly what she calls an ode to Black girlhood, right? So if you read Dr. Valerie Boyd's Wrapped in Rainbows, which is so beautiful, you'll hear Dr. Valerie Boyd telling this story that Zora Neale Hurston tells about this relationship to the moon she had when she was a child, and thinking that the moon only followed her, right? And what was it to be when she found out that the moon follows everybody else, right? So I'm thinking there's also something there as well, and thinking about this relationship that Hoyes is exploring about this particular kinship between the two of them, right? But also thinking about that, what does that mean for other kinships and relationships that folks have with Zora Neale Hurston and her archive, right? How is she negotiating this particular relationship that she has with Zora Neale Hurston? Not versus, not in opposition, but alongside what might some of these other relationships may be. Another quote that I want to pull, and just really honing in on this idea of Candace Hoyes exploring Zora Neale Hurston as an ancestral guide, is that she also quotes in the same interview, "I feel like Zora Neale Hurston has had a connection to me since the first day I turned the page of Their Eyes Were Watching God when I was in high school. And I was immediately connecting with so much of the issues she was referencing, colorism and sexism, the negotiation of what's respectable behavior, all those things that a Black teenage girl is defining for herself." And as she continues, she goes, "As I connect with Zora," and particularly thinking about this reference of the moon, right? And we can also think about the moon as a source of light, right? A source of light that is perhaps guiding, not perhaps, that is guiding Hoyes. She writes, "As I connect with Zora, the moon goes through phases, but the moon itself never changes. And the moon and the story about the moon becomes like a portal for me into the next work I want to make. It becomes an affirmation," right? Which is something that ancestors also provide a form of. "And it closes a certain sister circle between myself and Hurston," right? So really, once again, getting into this idea of ancestral guidance, ancestral connection that is being explored further in this work. Because this work is new to me in terms of thinking through it in this particular way, there are still some questions to discover here in terms of delving more into the lyrical references that can help me really build the foundation of this as a form of ancestor veneration, particularly the push and pull that you'll hear lyrically between, with Hoyes exploring this idea of like the moon and pulling from, right, Zora Neale Hurston, the moon following me, and my surprise when I find out that it follows everyone else as well. And then also sonically also, right, the fact that we hear the drum, right, the kick drum begins this song. What ancestral veneration might be happening there, right, unknowingly or knowingly, that Candace Hoyes and also her collaborators are engaging in within this song. The song that I want you all to check out, in addition to this and thinking about the ways that Zora Neale Hurston is being lifted within the Black music continuum, in this, you know, the present here and now, even though I just said time floats all around, but I'm just giving you specifics in terms of thinking within the past 3 years, is the work of Jamila Woods, who is out of Chicago, who is a songwriter and vocalist, who came out with an amazing, amazing body of work, Legacy Legacy, in 2019, in which she is crafting what she describes as these kind of self-portraits of various folks. Bette Davis, who recently transitioned. She has a song from Miles Davis on there as well, that is really interesting in grappling with his legacy. Also, Sonia Sanchez, Nikki Giovanni, and she has a song for Zora called Zora. And so I invite you to listen to that and maybe think about what are some of the connections that Hoyes and Woods are exploring and thinking about Zora Neale Hurston as an ancestral guide, you know, both a personal ancestral guide and then a collective ancestral guide for Black women. Right. So with that said, and Ellie, feel free to pop in terms of time, in terms of where.
Yeah. Well, first of all, maybe you can drop these links to the songs that you played and the song that you didn't play in the chat so people can save it for later. And yeah, I have something to call back again for the things that you have played, but maybe we can hear a bit from people in the audience, from our colleagues, maybe your thoughts, your questions. We can also share some of the questions we are thinking about and had in our kind of initial work in progress document that might inspire you to think and contribute. So I can put that in the chat, but yeah, let's open it up.
Is everybody being shy now? Is this going on?
I think there's some questions here, as you see, that I'm posting that might be relevant for those of you who do research, but also for those of you who are working in the archives. I don't know, Alan, or I see that Xavier Vatin is here. Maybe you would like to share from your research in the archive in the context of Lorenzo and the repatriation kind of aspect, or thinking about the problematics of the archive so far away from the community, and how Lorenzo Dow Turner, for example, collection happened to come to Indiana University to begin with. So yeah, this is an open invitation. I see we have a hand there. Tolehishel Kaling, do you want to unmute? And correct me if I don't pronounce the name. We cannot hear.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Okay. I'm a PhD student at the Elphinstone Institute in University of Aberdeen. I work on folk songs. My question is to Smith. As a student, if I heard it correctly, you are working on the music collection of your your parents or relatives, or?
Well, in thinking about, right, thinking about like some of these records on my wall, right, they belong to my parents. And so I'm interested in really thinking about how perhaps their record collecting practices, right, can be a sort of archive, and thinking through some of the artists that they were listening to and where ancestor veneration might show up in their work. So for example, even though this is not my, do I have it up here? Actually, I don't. So that's a bad example. Oh no, I do, I'm sorry. Okay, so all the way at the top, let me give you my screen here. Boom, let me pop it out. We have the work of Oscar Brown Jr. And this one is my mother's copy, right? And I had to buy another copy because she didn't have the record in it. I don't know what happened to the record, but that's neither here nor there. But I bring up Oscar Brown Jr., right? Particularly in thinking about his relationship to the work of, and we're gonna go over again to We Insist, Max Roach's Freedom Now Suite, right? There is particularly the song, two songs, Freedom Day and Driver Band, which I'm interested in thinking about within this context of ancestor veneration, right? And when they're talking about this particular moment and this history of enslavement, right? So thinking about perhaps what might be venerated through the relationship that Oscar Brown Jr. has as the songwriter of those particular songs. Ancestor veneration in terms of what vocal choices is Abby Lincoln making as she sings, what type of sonic choices is Max Roach as well as the rest of the band members making, and thinking and tying all of this together around ancestor veneration, if that makes sense.
Thank you. So my question is, when you write about people that you are related to, how do you deal with this, the self or the others, or what Barbara Chetlock would say, the participant observation and observation participant, because I'm having this dilemma when I work on my community song and I don't know how to deal with it. And of course, there are so many professors who have written so far, but I want to know from a student's point of view, how, if you have that kind of notion, how do you cope with or deal with when you write about music or about the people you know, or your community, or as you say?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. And that's something that came up a lot in an ethnography course that I was taking last year. And where I stand right now, and I think I'm gonna remain here, you know, I don't want to romanticize, right, in saying that because I am a Black woman scholar, that means I understand everything about Black music, right? And I don't want to also act as if there aren't particular spaces within my positionality where it is not that, and I wouldn't necessarily use the, I'm struggling with the word of outsider. So I'm thinking through this as well. I'm thinking about maybe somebody who is less familiar, right? To a particular community, to a particular group, to a particular aspect or a particular experience. But I'm starting from the positionality of that I am never an outsider to myself, right? I am never an outsider to myself and I'm never an outsider to my community. There might be different things to grapple within that, right? And thinking about the challenges of writing that, but I think far too often there is this, at least in my readings and understanding so far of this idea of the insider and the outsider, there's just far too much emphasis on the idea, particularly for Black scholars, particularly for, you know, scholars who are not white, in us being asked to really grapple with this question of, well, oh, how are you going to do this work if you are an insider, you know, the insider-outsider dilemma. If you have not read the work of Dr. Melanie Burnham, I would suggest that you read her 1985 SIM article, Culture Bearer and Tradition Bearer, an Ethnomusicologist's Research on Gospel Music, because I think that is a perfect text for thinking through these questions of what it is to be, and particularly using that language of insider outsider, how it is that she's navigating these different positionalities within the gospel communities that she is researching. As somebody who grew up in the church, as somebody who is a music educator, right, but somebody who is less familiar with a particular brand, and I can't remember if it's that she's Baptist and she's working with Pentecostal groups, or she's Pentecostal and she's working with a Baptist group, right, the less of the familiarity there in some of the ideas around music making that come up in that article. So that's a very long-winded answer, but it's so long-winded because I'm also very much thinking about it as well and kind of just really want to push against when we get these questions about how to write these things. And I think it's okay to be very firm in your positionality. Ellie has a really wonderful article about the work of Dr. Willis Lawrence James, in which he's really talking about the idea that it is his positionality as a Black man, right, that is so central and crucial to him being able to go and do the work that he does, and just being very, very clear about that. And I think that we have to take the same stances, of course, with nuance, of course, with rigor, of course, with thought, but taking some of those similar stances.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Ellie, if I may, I think in kind of this insider-outsider conversation, I think one of the things that we discussed when we met was thinking about this language around collector, right? And particularly thinking about the use of language and collector in describing the work that it is that Zora Neale Hurston is doing and people like Dr. Willis Lawrence James is doing. And so I was curious if we could delve a little bit into that and just kind of thinking about how did you decide to come to the use of the word collector? Is there any particular implications for you that you have for that word as you're using it within your research?
Yeah, thank you, Nia. This is a great question. I think there's a kind of a dual approach that I had to take. So one was in order to challenge the dominancy of white collectors, I had to name collectors. So to find people that I could make the case that of how widespread collecting was. So first in immediate kind of recognizable sphere, like Zora Neale Hurston, she collected music and recorded music and wrote about the music she collected. So she has several books that depict her ethnographic work. Also James and work. But then it became clear to me that we need that collecting is also associated with imperial setting of extraction and from the community and then where are these things are going. So I think the second step was to try to challenge through their articulation of their own practice towards more sharing and enlivening rather than collecting, and how that enable a more kind of temporal sometimes less tangible object to that collecting that will also enable us to recognize other forms of exchange, intellectual labor, sonic production, ancestral traditions outside of these imperial settings of the archives, of the recorded document. So performance had been really crucial, and I've realized how these five collectors that I've been researching, the work family, three generation or four people in that family, James and Hurston, were all working within the performative realm. So for example, Willie Snore and James have published our recording demonstration of African-American musical tradition, also trying to trace back Africanism within Afro-American, that's the title of it, Afro-American recordings. And John Work was also arranging and performing materials that he've studied and heard around the various communities that he met. And why I wanted to say that, because I think that collapsing slowly the definition of the collecting of the collector was also needed to think a bit differently about their position. So at the beginning, I thought that they have left a relatively smaller recorded documentation, for example, song recordings, because they had less access to recording equipment, to discs and to budgets and to funding and to other forms of support, which was the case. But at the same time, through their written work and kind of oral history testimony that has been conveyed through other people, it became clear that there was another element to that. And that other element maybe goes back to the things that you've mentioned before, which is like being like not seeing themselves as outsider, but seeing taking the responsibility of this intimacy, of this relationship, of this lineage, and how does that shape their responsibility of care? So for example, James is saying, we learned from Sterling Brown that James have told him, like Sterling Brown tell him like, why do you don't record like all this music? And sort of like laugh at him, tease him a bit. And he says like, once you recorded, they can access that. So we see how the, I've asked before how this history of extraction and appropriation of Black cultural production, both from the performing communities, but also from these collectors specifically, have shaped their relationship and suspicion with preservation mechanism that are associated with collecting. So I think that this performative and ephemeral and even educational platform were so significant in their preservation contribution that stays within the frameworks of the communities that practice the song or pass them forward, much more than the kind of the scholarly expertise that position these cultural expression as specimen in the archives that then needs to be studied and theorized. So we can then take it upon and ask, does it, like, for example, if a recording of this isolated community from, I don't know where in the rural South is now located at the Alan Lomax, or I don't know whose collection at the Library of Congress, and that community had stopped performing for this and that reason, this specific song, has this song or tradition survived, preserved? So it's, I think that through this collector, we can really rethink what we think about preservation. And as you heard Zora Neale Hurston herself, she recognized the expertise and the authority on the performance, but also on the preservation within the performing community. So I think that's the thing that we can think about today.
Yeah, you raise a lot of good points, and just kind of thinking quickly, because I see that there are some hands. Right, and thinking about this extractionist model that you're talking about in terms of thinking about like an Alan Lomax, or even think about, you know, what does the practice of collecting even mean within the formation of, right, the European Museum and also the American Museum, right, with both of us having museum backgrounds. And, you know, just as, you know, Zora Neale Hurston so perfectly captured it, as she said, you like my peaches, but you don't like me. Right. And so in relationship to that, just as you're talking about this idea of this embodied, what I would like to think about as Maya Cunningham puts it, this embodied self-discovery and the sharing, which you mentioned, as opposed to collecting, like that outsider language that fuels what it is that Alan Lomax is engaging in. Because Alan Lomax, now, I'm making an assumption here. I'm a little familiar with, you know, what he was doing, but I don't think he was trying to get down in the circle. And he didn't need to get down in the circle. We don't want him to get down in the circle, but I don't think he was trying to get down in the circle and be embodied and be in community in the ways in which we are thinking about with the work of Zora Neale Hurston.
He was counting on the warden with the gun to have the thing.
Right, right. And so thinking about the ways in which they are engaging in these acts of being bearers of culture and tradition. Yeah. I saw Dr. Abagunde's hand, and then Dr. Burdett's hand, and then somebody please let us know when we're supposed to stop. I know I'm supposed to be at the archives in a little bit. But
it's all part of the same thing. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you. This was so marvelous. I'm so glad that one of the few times I was actually looking at my email that this, or Facebook, after like a month, that this is what came up. I'm thinking of a couple of things, and I'm thinking as I'm talking in the archive. So I'm always thinking as the body is the primary archive and what gets held there and this embodiment. So you're making me think also about what is missing, right? So when we think about performance, particularly in Black communities and African traditions and the movement in the body and that embodiment, right? So I'm just really thinking about like what actually is not found in the archive right now. I'm thinking about Lorenzo Dow Turner and the language you cry in, and how that return of the family to the Carolinas, where they had to also enact the ritual, which comes with the body and movement as part of that song. And I'm also thinking about Lover's Rock, the small acts, and how everything that you need to know about that moment of time is contained in the music. But as a viewer and a listener, right, you're also pulled into it, so that the sonic aspect of that is actually marked on the body, right? The sonic aspect of that is actually opening cellular structure in a way that creates memory and recreates memory and connects past, present, and future, right? So all of these things are spinning around there. That's possible that just exist in the kind of questions that still have to be asked. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Abagunde. In response to that, I'm so glad that you, you know, brought up the body, right? Because that's a central part of, once again, right? And y'all, you know, everybody who is in here, please hold me to finishing this book within like the next 2 weeks, okay? Because we read some chapters from it in Dr. Jones's class, but I want to read the whole book so I can come beyond just the introduction in the first two chapters. But in those first three chapters and in the introduction, Dr. Floyd talks about, right, this trio that when, if we are thinking about Black music, if we are theorizing about Black music, we must do it in thinking about dance, drum, and song, right? These three are connected. The body is the body is intricate, right? In understanding the ways in which we are having this transmission of memory that you're talking about, Dr. Abagunde. So thank you so much for bringing that up.
I'll also add that Zora Neale Hurston, thank you for that too, was really concerned about the dance, and she collected also songs that relate to dance, and she speaks about it, but also in some of the recording, you can really, again, it's to hear, but it's also to imagine, to almost see through sonic representation, the movement and the bodily gesture that she's engaged through this idea of embodied archive, right? So she captures that too, but it's like, it's not visible maybe, but you can really hear, you can hear her breathe, you can hear her work, you can, it's really an immersive kind of performance. And also she did she was a pioneer of visual documentation as well. There are some early recordings that she shoot with a camera, moving images. So that's quite incredible to see alongside her work. And yeah, definitely everything that Floyd said and others. And we have Alan, maybe.
Yeah, thanks. Thanks to you both for lots of really thoughtful for this thoughtful discussion and lots of really interesting things to think about. One thing that comes to mind for me, particularly thinking about archives and the way we deal with history and historical context, and my general question is specific, but it can be extrapolated time-wise, and that is, you know, how important is the scholarly and political context of the early 20th century to your work? So I know you want to center the voices of Black collectors and Black performers, but they're not operating in a vacuum. They're operating in the context of white scholars, some of whom are doing their own form of ancestor veneration by, for example, collecting Anglo-American ballads, which is not just a form of antiquarianism, but is intentionally or unintentionally part of dialogues about white cultural purity as Jim Crow is being solidified in the United States, or is paternalistic in the case of the Lomaxes and Huddy Ledbetter, or that the collection of Black vernacular music is a counter narrative to the gross stereotypes of Black culture in American popular culture at the time. So I'm just curious how you're handling that larger social, political, scholarly context, while at the same time trying to center Black collectors and their voices in the nature of your work.
Yeah, thank you for that. So as I mentioned, it's a twofold kind of way forward with that. So one is to identify the kind of the wider context of this emergence of collecting. So I've been working a lot trying to understand the origination of, specifically in the US context, how kind of research paradigms and epistemological paradigms have been cemented, let's say from as the first kind of anthology that has been published with the Slave Songs of the United States in 1867. Sorry about that. And how that had been kind of serving the basis for what kind of 20th century white collecting practices will continue and reshape and shape and follow through. So one of these things is, of course, so it's equally embedded in whiteness. So you can see how whiteness has been constructed, both from othering, but also from, you know, things that we're familiar in many forms of cultural production and historical narrative is like the kind of the white savior. So it started as like this part of abolitionist work. So I think that what you were saying about this construction of whiteness is always embedded with that. And I think, I definitely engage with the wider historical context. I'm less interested or cannot, you know, there's a limit to how much we can absorb ourselves. It's such a complex web of collecting. So of course, our white collectors are exploring a variety of both Lomax and Halpert and other people that I've mentioned today have not just studied African-American folk music, but have engaged with other collecting to study the plurality of the people of the United States, their specific kind of biographical ancestry, etc. But I think that there's I'm separating that and how they approach that from how they look, observe, theorize, and perform while collecting African-American folk music, which I think is inseparable from the power dynamics at that time, from the hostile environment, from the precarity of Black lives, from the precarity of professional Black aspiration. I see the rise of these collectors at the expense of the Black collectors. I see how all of the Black collectors that I've been writing about have been fighting and to keep head above water by teaching summer in summer period, by taking a lot of external work to their academic work, by fighting for stability in their academic place, by being acknowledged for the work they're doing. So I mentioned they worked in HBCUs, but let us not forget that those HBCUs were often run by white administration. So I think this is inseparable. And I think, but there needs to be some kind of differentiation. And as I've said to Nia when we had a conversation, when I did the work on the Willis Lawrence James article, one of the kind of feedback I got from my reviewer number two, right, the most harsh critic, was that I'm using white collectors as a straw man and I don't speak about specific ones. And I said, yeah, because I think there's a place to make a categorical claim of white collecting practices in that time due to the historical context of this marginalization, this precarity of life, this violence and adversity. And also because, as I mentioned, I shape the parameters of my interpretation and sometimes arguments within the frameworks of the collectors that I'm studying. So if Willis Lawrence James is criticizing white collecting practices as a whole, he gives me the green light to do that as well. So I think that's really important, but definitely there are many faces to that. But I think this is, should be established at the same time, identifying the problematics and the complexities of white collecting practices, but also try to differentiate how we approach and centralize this African-American practice vis-a-vis that. But also just to end up with another issue. Oh, I lost my mind, 1 second. Okay, it might come back. So it may be, I hope that answers. And if you have something to follow up on that, Nia, you're totally welcome.
Yeah, I'm taking a bit of a different approach in my work in calling out the name of one of my theoretical and musical ancestors, who I failed to mention at the top, the work of composer and multi-instrumentalist Rahsaan Roland Kirk, which on his song Blackness, from 1972, I believe. I always get the year, 71 or 72. But he has a quote in the introduction to that song where he says, "We don't mean to eliminate nothing, but we're gonna just hear the Black notes at this time, if you don't mind," right? And my work is really focused on hearing those Black notes, those Black voices, this governance structure in which we're operating in and thinking about this idea of ancestor veneration. There may be somebody else out there who wants to do that work and thinking about the relationship of these practices to the larger body of whiteness, but that's not my interest at all, and particularly in not seeing my Blackness, right, and my African self as being as needing to be within within the structure, within a white structure, in terms of what's happening with the larger context there. I'm much more interested in thinking about what are these governance structures and what are these contexts that are happening at this time for Black folks, you know, here in the U.S., right, across the diaspora, that can help to really unfurl this idea of ancestor veneration. And I think it also just speaks to the idea of, like, the work of Toni Morrison, right, if we think about multiple interviews where she is asked about her particular work and, you know, what does it mean if there's no white characters in the work? Is it then very realistic? You know, I think about this scholarship in the same way, in thinking that, you know, there is room and there is space for the Black experience, the African experience, to be situated in a position without a discussion of whiteness.
Yeah, I just want to echo that. Thank you, Nia. This is a great point. What I've answered to you are things that I went through during my research. But when it comes to the things that I'm trying to push forward, and hopefully in the monograph would be following up on things that Nia said and I've said earlier, is to think about Black collecting practices not as a negation of white collecting practices, but for a second, leave them just out, like, you know, I might work it out in the introduction, but I want the body of the work to try to, as I mentioned, have a different point of departure, have a different kind of standard to adhere to, to unsettle these notions of center and margins that we are so obliged to maintain. So again, not to see those collectors at the margin, but to see them within the center of their communities and their practice. And I think that methodological shift was very, very important to me. And it was, and I could only get to that understanding because at the beginning, you know, I thought there was, I approached it differently. It took me time to learn. And I did learn from, for example, Dr. James a lot about that, from how he articulated his practice and his critique. So I think that's really important for me, not to to use, you know, counter or corrective measures such as hidden figures or just contrasting, you know, but just focus for a second about what they were doing without needing to excuse that. I'm not talking again about Alan Lomax, Halpert, Lawrence Gellert, et cetera. But I am aware of these and I am working through these other things, but I might choose not to centralize them in the writing at the end.
So I'm taking a moment to scan and I'm not seeing any other raised hands at the moment, but I just want to say thank you both so much for sharing your time and your expertise, inviting us into this conversation with you, really helping us to think about the richness of the archives and the richness of the things that are not in the archives and the work that those spaces can and can't do. And I look forward to these conversations continuing in other ways.
Suzanne, I just want to go, I will not say about it, but I just want to read Dr. Dahlia Scruggs' comment because it was there and I think it's a good ending note.
Please do, because it's not showing up for me, so absolutely. Right.
The clip that Dr. Azoulay played of Hurston made me think of dance. Hurston's description of learning the song through the participation reminds me of how dancer, even in European American tradition, passed down dances by embodying it, marking the body archive. The disciplinary frame seemed to offer an alternative to the dynamic of collecting. I would add that the interdisciplinary frame would add to the collecting. And I think that's something both Nia and myself share is this incorporation of various forms of approach from dance, from music, from culture and wide, from literature, from curation, from display. And I think all of that is needed in order to face the challenges, find new words, new concepts, etc. So thank you for that comment in the chat. Back to you, Suzanne, sorry.
No apologies needed, none at all. Actually, thank you for catching that and making sure that that was brought into the conversation as well. So yes, Abagunde is agreeing. Yes, the somatics and the sonic dance, yes.
Well, thank you everyone for coming. Thank you, Nia.
Thank you, Ellie. Thank you so much. Thank you everybody for coming. I appreciate it. We appreciate it. We're just very, very grateful and thankful.
Oh, well, so are we. So thank you to both of you, to our colleagues at ATM, and again, to my colleagues here who make all of these things possible. We greatly appreciate it. And to any of you who would like to participate in future presentations of this type, send us an email at ias@indiana.edu. And again, we appreciate your time. We're glad that you were here with us and we hope everybody takes care. Be well.
Bye. Thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye.